Julie Chalfont, Chair of the Finance Committee. I'm calling the Finance Committee meeting for December 7th, 2021 to order at 5:32 p.m. The first item on our agenda is review and approve previous minutes.
I'll move.
Move to approve.
Second. That's what she said, so I said, don't move. That's what we need to do.
What we used to do.
All right, so it's been moved and approved. Does anybody have any discussion or comments on the minutes?
It's been seconded.
I mean, moved and seconded. We'll get this figured out one of these days. Any comments? No? Okay. Well, I've been told that even though we are all present here in person, as long as it's hybrid, we have to roll call vote. So let's roll call vote.
Aye.
Yes, sir.
Skip Olmstead.
John Petrarch, aye.
John Pareski, aye.
Beth Brown, aye.
Julie Chalfont, aye.
James Cambius, aye.
All right, that was easy.
Nice job, Jim. Thank you.
So the next item on the agenda is Finance Committee membership, which I meant to do last week, but our new member is here, Beth Brown. So we're happy to have you join us. And I thought we would just quickly go around and like say who you are and a little bit about, your background or something. We did. You're right.
Brenda Hill, I'm the town accountant.
Skip Olmstead, member of the Finance Committee.
John Petrarch, been around this town for a long time. I was born in this town about 78 years ago. Before he went to the hospital to be born, so I'm probably the oldest one on the board. I had about 18 years as a selectman. I had several years, almost 20 years as a Franklin Regional Council of Government member. I've been on the fire district for about 13 years. Been on the finance committee for about 10 years. And other than that, I haven't done much other than ran a family and a town for.
Okay.
So I'm just a local guy.
John Pareski, member of the finance committee and the finance committee's representative to the personnel board. And I spent a number of years as chair of the capital improvement planning committee. My background is I was a CPA before retirement.
Okay. Background. I'm new to the finance committee. I'm on the recreation committee. I teach at GCC, math at GCC.
Those good math skills you bring to the finance committee, huh? I'm Julie Chalfont. I'm chair of finance committee this year, last year too, 2 years. Skip was past chair. What other experience? I'm on town building advisory committee. I did a bunch of stuff with PTA a long time, you know. Right now I work at MIT doing research into mechanical engineering and ship design stuff.
I'm Jim Cambius. I'm a member of the finance committee. I'm also on the library board.
And then Allison Vanderbilt isn't here. There's also a member. All right, check that one out. Next is financial indicator spreadsheet. So I've given 2-3 handouts. One is an updated version of the spreadsheet because Brenda has gone through a lot of stuff for us and we've updated it. And so as we go through, we'll go back and forth about what is changed from the previous version. Before we get into that, I gave out two other handouts. On the same web page that you can download all of this data that we're using in our financial indicator spreadsheet, you can also screen it and print out all the same data for other towns. And you can put ranges of information in. So I did two things. One of them is Franklin County. That actually says Franklin County comparison at the top. And it compares all the towns in Franklin County. And when you get down to the bottom, you see sort of separately, it says Deerfield rank out of 26 total towns. And for each of these categories, it says what rank we are. So we're the fourth highest in population, the fourth highest in single family tax bill, the seventh highest in equivalent value per capita, et cetera. It goes on across. I just picked some categories to print out. There's probably 100. So like all of the financial indicators we're looking at. So if anybody wants anything different to compare to, we can put something else on this. But I just thought, I don't think we need to talk about it today. I think just handing it out, and we can look at it and talk about it another time. The other sheet, you can...
Go ahead, sorry.
So the other sheet is a comparison. I tried to pick out towns that are similar to our town. And so, and the way you can screen all of the towns. So what I did was pick towns that were between a population of 3,000 and 7,000, with an income per capita between 30,000 and 55,000, and an EQV, which is equivalent valuation, which is essentially the total assessed value of the property in the town per capita, between 110,000 and 200,000. You can see down here at the bottom, there's a little chart thing, and over on the right you can see the Deerfield values. So we're sort of in the middle of those ranges. So I just had to pick something, so I picked something to try and get some towns.
This is the entire state, correct?
Out of the entire state, yes. So these are all, so there's 17 total towns in the entire state that fall within those ranges that we can use to compare ourselves to. Yeah.
The numbers are the same, but everything except the rank, I guess, is... Did you mean that to happen?
So the yellow line for Deerfield should be the same on both.
Yeah, okay.
Because that's our values.
What are the red numbers?
Oh, I was picking out the ones... I hope I didn't mess it up. So if you look at total expenditures, for example, we're the fourth highest town, so the three orange ones are the three other towns that are higher.
But you didn't do it for everything.
I didn't do
that's
it for everything.
That's what got confusing. I thought that's what it
yeah.
was. That makes sense.
Which number are we looking, are you speaking about total?
Like total population.
So on the Franklin County comparison page,
okay.
if you look at where it says total expenditures, mm-hmm. which is the first one in the right-hand set, we're fourth, and the three towns that are ahead of us are highlighted in orange, and it's, orange, and Montague, and
Greenfield.
Which makes sense, because those are also the three that are bigger than us.
Right, we're fourth in population as well.
Yeah. So as we look at, so I did make one change to this from the data that we downloaded, because our tax rate doesn't include the fire and the water district. So I added the South Deerfield fire district and water district rates to our tax rate.
Did you also add Deerfield area protection?
I didn't.
Okay, because those are the
because
three.
Nobody pays all three.
True.
Right?
Good point. Yes.
So
which no. column are you?
Did so
you
that do? Is the residential tax rate. The,
okay,
where it says
go.
17.95 next to last column. Right? So I didn't add anything. Like the total budget is just our municipal budget. It does not include the budgets for the fire district or the water district or... That just seemed too hard, but the tax rate I had handy, so I added it in there. I can take it back out if nobody likes that, but it seemed like a fair comparison to me because I think most other towns don't have, I don't know what these towns do, but most of the towns I think do not separate. They have all that stuff in their budget.
In most cases, I don't think it makes any difference whether you put those in or not. I think the one thing that's going to be very important to everybody in South Deerfield and some in Old Deerfield is going to be the sewer.
Mm-hmm.
The sewer is going to be a major, major, major
yes.
problem. And based on the projections that they said a couple of years ago, that after this thing's rolling for 2 or 3 years and we start paying on it, instead of paying $500 a year, you're going to be paying $2,000 a year. They show projections of over $2,000 a year per household.
Oh gosh.
That's a major, major, major disconnect in our tax rate. And all I want to do is point that out, that we do have that major problem coming up, so, but we've been very good on taxes. All of a sudden, we're going to be very lopsided on taxes.
I agree, and the other thing that's going to happen is that's going to show up in people's sewer bill.
Absolutely.
Not in the tax bill. So when we sit here and look at the taxes, we're not looking at the full picture.
That's right.
We're not seeing that sort of.
Matter of fact, that's going to be a disconnect of probably 25% or more. Because instead of paying $6,000 in taxes, you're going to be paying $8,000 plus your water and sewer.
Okay. So I don't, nobody's seen this before, so I'm just, now you have it, and you look at it, and we can talk about it later. But those are the questions I had. Okay, so for financial indicators, we said we were going to try and do 1 through 5, and if we got through those, and it, we still had time, we'd go no more. So, starting with indicator 1, total receipts, Brenda looked at it and realized that these were our projected values, not our actual values. So the new one that I handed out has actual values on it. The trend is pretty similar looking, but the numbers are slightly different. And I also did not put on this the enterprise and CPA funds. Because that seemed sort of unnecessary and separate. And we didn't have an easy way to do it. We could add those back if anybody thinks we need to. So, and then, last time we were going through this, I don't think that you were here. This analysis is just what I wrote down when I was doing it, so that's what we need to discuss, is what people think, whether there's, you know, we should change that analysis of the range. So does anybody have any thoughts on?
We're looking at number 1, total receipts, right?
Yep, indicator 1, total receipts.
The only comment that I have is that I think you're absolutely right. I agree with you.
Okay.
Now,
this seems fine, then, to me.
On these property tax local receipts, net state aid, these are actual dollars, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I have a question. How much has the of this increase in receipts reflects increases in rate?
What's that?
How much of the increase in receipts reflects increasing rate?
Well, your rate is based on your value, so sometimes your rate goes down, sometimes it goes up. You're talking about taxes.
And there's actually a separate indicator that looks at the tax rate.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Could we just take 1 year and kind of go across and go through just to make sure that...
Yeah.
And I'm scared what year we take.
Let's do 2021.
Yeah.
21's fine. So the property taxes for 21, this is total taxes, right? $12,861,700.
Yep.
Doesn't
include. It includes excluded debt.
It does include it. Okay.
Yep.
It does include it.
Sure.
And you know that
because those are your actual tax receipts.
Local receipts.
To women on property tax, we skip a second. It doesn't include fire district or sewer, right?
Right.
And it wouldn't, because that's a pass-through.
Yeah. Right. Local receipts, those are the total, the actual?
That's the local receipts that are reported back to DOR when we do our tax recap, yes.
And net state aid is what it says.
Correct.
And we do spend free cash.
Mm-hmm.
Where's
right,
free cash
and that's
from?
Actually on our next page.
Yep, it's on another page.
So total revenues are just that. That's
right.
Right.
That's just actual revenues.
Okay.
that we take in.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting. State aid hasn't changed much at all in 10 years.
Well, that's the
a little bit, but not much.
That's the state aid that goes into the general fund. It has nothing to do with the charges. The charges aren't taken off of there, and it doesn't have anything to do with the two items that go into special funds, the school choice and the library aid.
It says net, what's it net of then?
It's just net receipts. It probably should say gross, but it's...
It's off this sheet.
Right.
Which is the one, do I have a net of charges on that?
It should be net of charges.
It's revenues and charges, and then it's net, so it's net of charges, whatever charges are.
Okay, never mind, yes, yep, I apologize.
The only thing that I'll point out, or it's not the only thing I'll point out, but I would point out that if you look at net state aid, it's been pretty constant. But during that time, property taxes have risen 50%.
That's a good point.
Yep.
Local receipts have risen, whatever it is, 20%, 25%. Net state aid, it's actually dropped down 1 or 2%.
So as a percentage, it's not keeping up.
Right.
Absolutely not.
And part of that is because the state figures that we're wealthy.
Yes.
There's a perception there.
Sure
is. And I've always, that's something that I argued with for years and years and years. And at times people say, well, let's take $25,000 and put it into our savings account stabilization fund. And I would always argue against that. The reason I would argue against it is because we already look right now, we want to take another $25,000 charge to taxpayers for $25,000 put into the savings account to look richer. Why do we want to look richer? Doesn't make any sense. But that's, you know, that's where you got to have both sides of the equation where you can turn around and say, yes, this is good, this is great, but if we get a stabilization account that's healthy, we don't have to beef it up every year. And the only other thing I'd say about the state aid, when you figure out that we keep going down and down and down and down, when you compare it to your cost of living going up, we're losing even more.
So actually, since we're talking about state aid, if we look at indicator 3, that's state aid.
The new sheet.
And on the new sheet, yeah. And so if you look at these are receipts and assessments, and then the net state aid is receipts minus the charges. But if you look at it, the farthest right column is the percent. State aid is a percent of our total revenues. And exactly what you said, John, is that it goes from 12.6% to 9.1%. So we're definitely dropping as a percentage of our revenues. So does this include... the pay for the kids that go to the school?
School choice.
School choice, there we go.
No.
This does not include school choice.
Oh. I don't know without looking at the state aid sheet. The sheet I've given you for the history does not include school choice.
This sheet?
Correct.
Okay, in case, so cross out that much of the decrease is school choice because I just took the number straight off this sheet.
Okay, yeah, school choice goes into a separate fund altogether, has nothing to do with the general fund, so it wouldn't be in my history there.
Okay. That is back to the comment.
If you go back and look at
it. Right, because then that's a decrease. That even shows even a greater decrease because of that has dropped drastically.
Well, if you look at the school budget and you look at the complete budget, the 20-page one they give you, they break up their budget. Taxes, blah, blah, school choice. So in this... the expenditure for the school expenditures that come out of property tax, but they're not. We're probably not showing the school choice expenditures. The use of the school choice money.
Right. Okay.
That's my guess. I'm not 100% sure of that because of the way they budget.
Unique thing.
Basically, agree with that. That's
your staff.
Would you agree with that, or basically?
Decrease the percentage because they think we're affluent community?
Yeah.
But
that's part of it. They're not going down with other communities.
I mean, yeah, I guess I wonder what the trend is with other communities, if it's the same.
Well,
some communities are getting more and some communities are getting less, right? Because they were trying, I thought the state has been working to try to equalize that, and they were...
That's all part of socialism.
Yes.
You know, you get too much money, we'll take some away from you and we'll give it to our poor community.
Yes.
Now, here's an interesting...
Let's balance it all out for everybody.
Does this include grants as well as, or is this just state aid to the town budget?
Oh, no, this is just cherry sheet state aid, so that has nothing to do with grants.
So it's not like we're, not applying for things that we could...
Right, grants are completely off the books here, you know, when we're talking about the stuff we're talking about in these, on this spreadsheet.
What are the charges and assessments on this page, on the state aid page?
So they charge us for school choice, for children who go to another school, or charter schools.
So that's included on this?
That's in the charges. It also includes the public transportation, the...
Franklin County Transportation Authority.
Correct. RMB marking charge and an air pollution district charge. I think that's it.
The good thing is we don't have a lot of air pollution here. Boston does, but we're paying for it.
I'll still take the matter in.
Those went up a lot over...
Yeah, they did.
Most of the increase is due to charter schools and school choice.
And the funny thing is, when you take a look at school choice, another interesting figure is that they cap the amount you can charge a student coming in, $5,000. But yet it costs us $13,000 or $14,000 per kid to educate every kid. So each kid you bring in, it's a minus $8,000.
And also the charter schools, I think it costs more to sign when it's choice out.
That will show a full boat. So for example, then you can correct me, it's roughly $20,000 for a kid to attend the tech school in Northampton.
Smith.
And we pay it.
That's right, yes.
Even though we pay it here, the kid may be a high school kid, but it comes out of our budget.
All right.
Parking's up for taxes.
Since we're talking about state aid, I wrote down marginal because it's decreasing. I don't know if there's anything we can do about it, but does anybody have any opinions on that?
Doing so far, you're doing great. I totally agree.
Let's go back to indicator one. Does anybody have any other comments on indicator one? We got sort of distracted with state aid.
The only thing that I'd point out, excluded debt.
Mm-hmm.
It shows up very nicely here, basically. So for 15, 16, and 17, the only excluded debt I think we had for those years, could be wrong, is the highway garage. And basically, the only debt has been the highway garage all along. Got a couple of pieces that are coming in, but that's largely the highway garage.
Oh, yeah, mostly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So not 100%.
I would say 2015 is definitely just the garage. I thought the school roof started in 2016, but I
it could be, or maybe 2018. You look at the difference.
I see the difference. I see it.
17 and 18.
Yeah.
We still on indicator one?
Yep.
Right.
Yeah. Down at the bottom where it says excluded debt.
There's an orange
right.
Column that says excluded debt. I meant to print out that list of the debt that you sent to us, and I forgot.
You want me to
print
that out for everybody real quick?
If you have it handy, that'd be great.
I can go grab it.
I guess I don't think total receipts is favorable. Based on what Skip pointed out, the state aid percentage going down. I think that by itself. It makes it unfavorable. It's just my opinion, of course. I think we need to vote as a committee, but and it's. I figured we need to compare it to the operating budget as well before we make a determination as to favorable, marginal, or unfavorable.
Okay.
That's my opinion.
So the guidance that came with the spreadsheet was that if you have revenues that are increasing over time, that shows that you can continue to fund what you need to do, but they don't talk about it relative to what your expenses are.
One of the things that would be interesting to look at on this would be property taxes versus tax rate.
So we'll get to that. There's another sheet that has that.
All right.
And we'll get to that. Maybe we don't pick something on indicator one. Let's do some of the other indicators and we can come back to this one. So indicator two, I totally redid because it was a mess. And I confused Brenda on the whole thing. So what I was trying to get at was, are we spending sort of one-time funds, stuff for our municipal budget? And so the new indicator, every year when we vote the omnibus, it says, so much raise and appropriate, so much from all these different categories. These are, Brenda dug that up for us. So in this
indicator two. Oh, the Schedule A?
Yeah, the Schedule A stuff.
Yeah.
So in this section where it says general fund, that's our omnibus budget. Thanks. And then the free cash column is free cash. The other column down at the bottom is all amortization of the garage loan. The top four there, 2013 through 2016, were different funds that were tapped to support the budget. There was a municipal building fund, there was something else, I don't know what, but that was something.
Insurance indemnification fund, a municipal building fund, and I can't remember what the third fund was, but it was like, wow. So this is how they were getting money for the budget.
Yeah. But the good thing is that we aren't doing that anymore. We haven't done that since 2017. So
since we wiped out those accounts.
Well, we wiped out
correct.
Not quite, but close.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. No, I think you've wiped them all out completely.
We tried. Right. We didn't wipe out free cash yet.
So this gives us an indication of free cash that we are spending for essentially operating costs rather than capital improvements or something like that.
The source of free cash is, how does that differ from raising and appropriating?
So free cash is this isn't the exact calculation, but it's pretty close. You have leftover free cash from 1 year, so you start with that on the coming year, plus any revenues over and above what you budgeted, and any expenditures less than what you budgeted,
basically,
except for what you've carried forward.
So for cushion.
What's that?
It's basically leftover.
It's basically a for-profit company's retained earnings, you could say,
So for cushion.
Yeah, like they say, it's not free, maybe cash, but that's the only thing.
Well, it's not even really cash, it's value.
Yeah.
But it is essentially previous year's raise and appropriate that just happened.
That's left over.
So,
yeah.
Right. It's all in basically the appropriations, just the leftover funds that weren't spent.
And what it does is give you a cushion to spend should you need to for things. And the advice that I've seen is that, I'm not going to remember the numbers. So we generally try and target having a certain amount of free cash available at the end of the year before budgeting. And it is, I think, considered good practice to be conservative in your estimates of your revenues and try and not spend spend everything in your expenses so that you have some cash available for the upcoming year for things that you need.
For one-time expenditures.
For one-time.
How does that differ from the stabilization?
Cash reserve would be a bit building up.
Right, or to put, right, like put into the reserves, correct.
So the stabilization fund is money that you intentionally put away as part of your budgeting process, right? Just quizzing me on this stuff to make sure I get it right. And the stabilization fund is in the bylaws, and in order to take money out of the stabilization fund, you have to specifically vote that at town meeting with a two-thirds?
Two-thirds.
Vote, or if it's a special town meeting, isn't it 9/10?
I think it's different for special town meeting.
Yeah, and that's a state requirement.
And you can also have stabilization funds for specific purposes, depending on how you write the bylaw that establishes it.
But they can be used for any purpose.
So I wonder, we look at free cash on here, the usage of it is going down. That could be looked at as being a good thing.
Yeah.
We didn't need to use it, or we didn't have as much as we wanted.
Right.
Could be either way.
So I would, this is use of free cash only for operating purposes, right? So free cash that we use for capital or one-time expenses are not, is not on here.
So that's not an appropriations either, Brenda? Capital?
Right, that would be our omnibus budget. So the only capital that's in our omnibus budget, so to speak, is from 2015 on, is for the police cruiser. Everything else is, you know, so that's all operating expenditures. So when I was picking out numbers for this, I looked at all articles that supported the omnibus budget or operating budget. And I don't know if you remember, but in some of the previous fiscal years, you know, several years ago, we were voting separately for the unfunded sick leave reserve. We were voting separately for the FERCOG assessment and taking that out of free cash. We were voting separately for, I can't even remember the other ones, but there were several line items that we then brought into the omnibus budget, and so now we vote that as part of the omnibus budget. So all of the free cash that we use for those items is included in here also, so that you get a picture that hopefully is comparing apples to apples. Does that make sense? Probably not. I probably muddy the waters. Okay.
So I agree, John. I think if you look at the past 5 years, our use of free cash has decreased for operating expenses, and that's a good thing.
Well,
if we have.
If you look at free cash, EMS is an operating expense.
Yes. Yep. So
and
the total free cash on the right includes the EMS free cash.
Correct.
Now, one thing you could do to improve this thing next time, see, you have the EMS fund down there.
Mm-hmm.
Should have a separate column for the sewer fund, because that's an enterprise fund also.
Right, but there was no use of free cash for the wastewater treatment plant. So that's what she's referring to here, is the use of free cash for operating.
Why are we using free cash to pay for the EMS?
Because we don't have any other money.
I can't that just be raised in purpose.
Because we don't have any other money.
Because we have the 2.5% limit on how much we can raise it. So we use that full 2.5%, and then we still can't cover our entire budget with that 2.5%. So we put the cash in.
Because we the other one, as we can talk about it, is that we tend to underestimate the amount of money, and maybe we need to look at that. And I know that that's done specifically. For example, you went back and took a look, let me just look down here for a minute. Local receipts. So if you look at 2020 local receipts, that's on page one, we had $2,268,000. If you go back to the budgeting process we used, the estimates that we used for budgeting purposes were far less than that. I think you probably find it's about 1.5, 1.6 million.
Correct.
That'd be about right. So that's where, so that turns into free cash.
Part of that does, yes. But you also don't collect all of your taxes in any given year. So your underestimation of local receipts covers that, and for the abatements and the exemptions that you give that you never collect on.
That confused everybody enough?
So you could, to put what you said another way, just to make sure I'm with you. You could decide, we could decide that we want to trim down our budget closer so that the extra cash that comes from not spending all your budget goes away, and we could, which would reduce our total budget. And we could reduce the, be less conservative on our estimates of income. And that way, if we did that, then we could meet more of our omnibus budget, but it would reduce the amount of free cash we have available for next year. And that free cash is much more flexible.
In a way. If you notice, we typically have a town meeting, a special town meeting in September, October. And the funds that we use, that we spend there, are 95% free cash, or pretty close to that.
So that would mean there was less free cash available for that fall town meeting, which is maybe okay.
Or if we did a better job of budgeting in the spring, so those funds that we spend in October were showing up in the annual budget.
Then we would vote that at the annual town meeting.
So I can think of one, I think it was one of the first years that I was on the finance committee. We ended up with something like 1.7 million in free cash. And both.
That was a long time ago. You must have been ancient.
I'm ancient now. Almost as ancient as you. I keep trying to catch up, but I don't manage to do it.
I'm not going to let you.
I hope not. But it seemed to me that we came in that October, we weren't watching what we were doing. But in this case, and I'm going to point to two, both the highway department and the police department, it was like a feeding frenzy.
Boy.
Yes.
Does this EMS have an end, or is this do we continually need to have? That's an operating budget?
It's an enterprise fund. They collect bills for their, but the bills don't cover everything that they do. Although I feel like last year, he said that over the past few years, he's been reducing the amount of retained earnings because, this is my impression, it just started up in 2016, and so there was some sort of settling in and making sure they understood where the money was going and whatever, and they're getting more comfortable with the estimates that they have.
I think they're more comfortable now because instead of renting from the fire district, they have their own place. So they have their own home now.
Right.
And it's very stable in funding and stuff, rather than money just going out to the fire district.
It did start in 2015,
But we used no free cash to support it because we still had money in our ambulance fund in 2014 to use for 2015. So in 2015 began the three-town ambulance service, so that's the difference. It was a Deerfield ambulance service, it moved into a three-town service, and so each town supports that budget. So ours is the largest share, we're at about 51.76%, right? And then Sunderland is 30-some percent, and Whately is like 16%. So I believe it was never intended to be self-supporting. So I believe that that will continue forever, right?
Right.
Yeah, it was never, it wasn't
self-supporting. It will never pay for itself totally.
And it wasn't self-supporting when the only thing was the Deerfield. This is...
Correct.
We did spend a little less than this, but we also didn't have people on staff full-time, 24 hours a day.
Correct. Yeah, we didn't have the level of service that we have
yeah.
now.
Yeah.
Well, I have a question. Why isn't this part of the budget?
It is.
I mean, why isn't it funded the way other things are funded?
We don't have the money.
But we're creating the money essentially by...
We have the money in free cash.
So what we could do, I mean, that amount will still be subsidizing EMS by some number, $300,000 a year, as far as we see. It doesn't necessarily have to come from free cash. If we were to, you know, over the years get to the point where we had more raise and appropriate available, we could pay for that out of raise and appropriate instead of out of free cash. And if you look at the free cash under the omnibus budget, I mean, last year we were down to $9,000, so we're doing pretty well on the rest of the budget. If we get that down to zero, then we can start picking away at the EMS.
What's the purpose of putting the EMS fund free cash on this indicator?
Because that's an operating budget that we're using free cash for.
So we use $309,000.
Right, because that's our subsidy to their budget, and we've been using the last 6 years using free cash totally to support that budget.
Let me ask you a question, because I'm not 100% clear on this. If I look at the 2022 budget, that's the current year we're in now, the raise and appropriate, that was what we did at town meeting, the annual town meeting.
Well, we fixed it at the special town meeting to that.
Let me go back one.
Yeah.
15,186 and 21, that was strictly annual town meeting, is that correct?
Correct.
And what's not showing here is the $500,000 or $600,000 that we spent at special town meeting.
Right, because anything that we spent for a capital or a one-time expenditure or even the reserve mm-hmm. fund is not included in this picture.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Just for operating, expected operating expenses.
So one of the things that we have in capital is equipment, whether it's, I don't know if I, because it may not be computers, is that capital?
The little bit of money that we set aside for IT hardware is in the operating budget. It's in the omnibus budget.
Okay, so that's not capital.
Not right.
Okay, but we have several hundred thousand dollars typically in any given year, $100,000 or $300,000 that we call capital. But for all intents and purposes, it's an operating expense. It's the trucks that the highway department uses. We don't buy them every year, but we do buy them every 2 or 3 years. The cruiser used to be kept in capital. I just assumed put it back there, not because but it is an operating cost. But so are the highway mm-hmm. equipment. Those are operating costs.
Sewer replacements and sidewalks. And it seems like there's an awful lot of things which are operating expenses that we are pretending are capital expenses.
Yeah, I'm not sure what you do with highway, what you do with sidewalks.
Well, For generally accepted accounting principles, they would be considered capital because they're extending the life of, you know, your repairs are extending the life of your of your equipment. And anything in this town, anything over 10,000 is considered capital if in fact it either extends the life or it's a replacement of something. So that's the use cap of the word capital can change based on what entity you're with. And
I mean, these are fairly predictable replacement cycles that we, in my opinion, ought to be considering as essentially another aspect of operating funds rather than borrowing. We don't borrow for cars or trucks. Okay.
There was, as when I was on the Capital Improvement Planning Committee, the police cruiser, they used to buy one every year. They had five, so like one fifth every year. And it used to go to the Capital Improvement Planning Committee, and we looked at the bylaw of the Capital Planning Committee, and it said that the CIPC should review anything that is non-recurring and has a life of more than 10 years. And we took the position that the police cruiser is recurring because they buy one every year. So for the police cruiser, it's in the operating budget. But for the truck, it's not. And maybe it should be. Maybe the bylaw needs to be changed. I tend to agree with Skip. It's,
I feel like there should be a, like a, you can call it capital or whatever, but essentially a town, a maintenance budget,
yeah,
that we spend a certain amount every year to maintain things like sidewalks and buildings and that kind of thing. Yeah.
Makes sense.
Where would the money come from?
Free cash.
Well, yes, in a way it would, because it would essentially iron out some of the peaks and valleys of spending, right? If you're budgeting, say, I'm making this up, $10,000 a year for sewer funds, then over 10 years you're spending $10,000 a year rather than spending nothing and then $100,000.
Well,
your capital stabilization fund was intended to be able to
do just
right.
That.
I guess what happened to that last year?
Well, it leveled out the budget.
But you grabbed $200,000, so you played with sidewalks.
$150,000.
So, quibble over $50,000.
Yes.
All right, so back to indicator two. Does this tell us something useful?
Yes.
Anything that we should change or update on it? I'm not hearing anything. Do we want to make an opinion on favorable, marginable, unfavorable, whatever?
For what I indicated to?
On indicator two, net operating revenues, yep.
I felt no opinion.
No.
Until we see it laid, I guess we need to see it laid next to expenditures.
Okay.
My opinion. Anyway.
So I wrote a comment on this one just because I didn't have any place else to put it. We aren't looking at anything that has to do with grants. Do we care?
We do probably care. One of the places that we, because we've had a pretty substantial amount of free cash, is we have used free cash as that portion that we have to raise. The MVP program most recently is the one.
The cash,
but like matching funds for grants.
We used stabilization for the largest one, but we did use free cash for two smaller ones. This year we're just using contracted services apparently, so.
Ideas right now about grants, but we'll put that on the to-do Sunday list. indicator four, here's our property tax revenue piece. And then there's a bunch of supporting ones. So you want your property tax revenue to not to decrease, I guess.
So let me ask a question. I'm not sure I understand what property tax levy constant dollars.
What that is adjusted for inflation, and they're in 2021 dollars. So you, that CPIU number is consumer price index number for Massachusetts. So it's not necessarily for Deerfield or for Western Mass, it's for all of Massachusetts. And it's a number that's supposed to represent inflation.
So if I look at this and I look at 2012, mm-hmm. and I see the number 90.7, and I look at 2021 and I see the number 100. Am I to conclude that over that 10-year period, the inflation rate for the entire 10 years has been roughly 10%?
Yep.
So if I put two initials next to it, a B and an S, give me what my thoughts are. I'm not sure what. So I'm not questioning the word, but it's like it doesn't frankly make that much sense to me.
What it's supposed to do, so if you look at the property tax has gone up, and then you're going to say, well, some of that is due to inflation, and some of that is due to, I don't know what.
The 2.5% max, and we can raise it.
Yeah, or 2.5%.
Well, but I guess the inflation is what I'm thinking about here, is this. Inflation rate, I guess.
Yes,
10% over.
Very dodgy to me, too.
It's rather.
I mean, it's showing in 2017 an actual negative inflation rate.
Apparently.
We have not had negative inflation since the Great Depression.
1921. I mean, 2021, maybe.
Send the stake
off that same DLS website.
The state gave it to you then.
Yeah.
Okay.
Somewhere I wrote down where it came from. Oh, here at the bottom of indicator one, it shows this DLS gateway. That's the link to the consumer price index thing.
I think they all make sense except for a couple of years in the middle there.
Yeah, I think the important thing on this spreadsheet is that final column, property tax as a percent of operating revenue. Don't you think? I don't know.
That's compared to inflated.
Yeah, I guess that's using the property tax.
In constant dollars.
Well, is it or
no? No, because the operating revenue changes as a percent of operating revenue. So it's just the property tax divided by the total
property
tax.
Okay, I'm doing the collection then.
So it's, yeah, they both correct.
But it doesn't include debt exclusion.
I'm just writing myself a note to check. It should not. It should be property tax. Does it matter? I guess it does matter.
I think
what it should be is property tax minus excluded debt divided by total operating revenue minus excluded debt. Right.
As it stands, so debt exclusion is subtracted from
it. Oh, it is. Okay. Yeah. And it should be, and it's excluded here, so hopefully.
So the net property tax levy plus debt exclusions equals property tax levy.
Right. So net property tax levy divided by net revenue should be that last column. Hopefully it is.
What do you think, Beth? You calculating?
I was looking at something.
I guess.
I was trying to figure this out.
Just means compared to, you take property tax revenue, local receipts, and state aid.
Yep.
And property tax is kind of stable.
Filling in for that state aid loss.
Yeah, but it's stable at 75, 72, 88, 75.
So it's not too bad. So our local receipts must have.
I think it means a whole lot.
Which one is that? What you're talking about, John?
Indicator 4, right?
Mm-hmm.
Property tax percent of operating revenue has pretty much stayed the same. Which means if we take our total operating revenue, it's kept in line with state aid and local receipts. So local receipts, if state aid's going down as a percentage, local receipts must be going up, right?
Yeah, yep.
Motor vehicle taxes have been pretty healthy the last few years. I would attribute it mostly to that because that's our biggest local receipt number.
But what does that mean? I guess like.
Well, our local receipts are making up for.
The decrease in state aid.
The decrease in state aid.
So maybe at some point, we're looking at, it's pointing out, I mean, local receipts are only going to be able to increase so much. I mean, we're going to get whacked with property tax revenue. Or because of Proposition 2.5, we might have to do an override. Could be going in that direction.
Especially with inflation. All right.
So in any event, I look at these and I look at some of this data, and I'm not suggesting that you play with the data. I'm saying, you know, this is the data, wherever you're getting it from, seems to be a little questionable. Not that the data's wrong or anything, but like, I wish I could remember that saying about use of numbers and, you know, that people use numbers and then,
yeah. So I think what we're trying to say is that our property tax, you want your property tax levy to, at a minimum, not decrease if you ignore inflation. So you want the real value of what you're getting from your property tax levy not to drop over time. And you need to pull inflation out of that so that you're not masking a loss in value.
We haven't had problems with inflation for several years now, but we're starting to develop it right now.
Right.
And what that's going to do, I don't know.
Yeah. I think it's going to cause us problems with Prop 2.5.
Good.
Some of the services you buy, they just keep adding and adding and adding, and that's where you run into the problem.
So I don't know what to do with that CPI. I mean, that's a value that they give us that, you know, other than not using anything.
Is there a statutory requirement about which consumer price index to use? Or can you essentially
say that again?
None of this is statutory.
In other statutory. Words, just there is. So, I mean, well, but it is, right?
I was going to say the
property to Prop 2.5 override, and then, for example, that scales up with what? Consumer price index? Or?
No.
So that's just.
2.5.
Okay.
You're subject to a 2.5% increase plus any new growth you have, and then the excluded debt adds to that, which is why you see, I was just looking at, where was I looking at?
There's other, actually, why don't we look at indicator 4A?
I was looking at the percent of change from the prior year on indicator 4, and that isn't 2.5% because of those two other factors, the new growth and the excluded.
Right. Now, new growth is, in other words, actually increased in value as well, right?
Yeah, it's kind of a number.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, we're not just squeezing more, the pie is getting bigger, we're not just squeezing.
Right.
Actually, the 4A is interesting. In particular, we'll look at the override capacity as a percentage of the levy ceiling.
Yes.
So, debt. Would you explain the levy limit?
You can explain the levy limit.
I'll give a stab at it. So there's two pieces of Prop 2.5. One is that the total amount of money that you took in from property taxes last year can be increased by 2.5% this year, plus new growth, plus debt. That's one piece of it. The other piece of it is that there's a limit of 2.5% of the EQV, which is essentially the assessed value of all property.
Correct.
That's and that is a hard limit that you're not allowed to exceed.
And that's the ceiling.
So how do you calculate, I don't have it with me, I've done it quite a few times, but how do you calculate total tax levy or levy limit? Levy ceiling.
The levy ceiling.
That's a straight calculation. It's
the levy ceiling is just 2.5% of the equalized value. So if you look at the page indicator 4C, the right hand most column is our equalized value. It's done every other year.
Okay. 2.5% total assessed value, right?
Yep. So 2.5% of $808 million should be our.
How about 2.5% of, if you look over here, $775,834,000.
Right. Okay. So it's total assessed value, not equalized value?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Well, we don't have a calculator big enough for that.
It's actually really informative that most of our money comes from residential property.
It does, yep.
So we can take a break here and take a little nap as Sean's going to make that calculation, 2.5% of assessed total assessed value. So wait, we have to
is that the levy? Are we supposed to be matching it with the levy ceiling?
And yes,
so the levy ceiling is, that's the 2.5% increase from last year plus new growth.
The levy ceiling, correct.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I took 2.5%.
$775,000.
Okay, I think I
thought. Yeah, I let DOR make those calculations. It always looks decent, but.
$19,395,857.
The
so that levy ceiling. That's
yeah,
that 19.5.
So
that
take, take a look if you would. At
2.5% of this.
Which indicator?
This is C.
Oh, okay.
Or C. And then it matches with this one. So, of course, this 2.5% of that's going to match this number.
So, if you take a look at the total tax levy, correct me if I'm wrong here before I go very far. That's the total amount that we anticipate or that we say we're going to raise from taxes.
Mm-hmm.
We never raise that amount because, but that's the estimate that we use during the appropriation or during the town meeting.
And that is the value of the bills that are sent out.
That's what I was going to ask. That's what we're being asked.
Yeah. Then you have your abatements and your exemptions And the people that don't pay their bills.
I was thinking.
So if you look at the, that number and then the levy ceiling, that's the total amount, that's the maximum that we can raise. And for 2011, we were at approximately 50%, give or take.
Yep.
We were actually below 50%.
Yep.
Of our levy ceiling. And every year after that, we are raising more money. Our, in other words, our taxes are going up faster than our levy ceiling is going up.
Yes.
So we're at the point now where we're taking 60% of that levy ceiling.
But if you look at 2017 to 2021, you're hovering around the 40% mark in
yes.
all of those years.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which I think is encouraging.
Look at the tax rate, you watch the tax rate, see what happens to the tax rate. They are interrelated, it's amazing.
When you just said that this number was the total tax levy was the amount that the bills went out, right? But then you said there's exemptions. So don't you know those ahead of time? Like
some of them they do, correct. Yeah.
But
some of them come off of the top right away.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like $25,000 worth, right off the bat. But then you have other ones that happen during the year, and as a matter of fact, they're working with something right now that might have been a miscalculation where we might be giving an abatement of maybe $11,000. So there's another one. So you have all these other ones that happen during the year, overvaluations, so on and so forth. Maximum levy limit is what you're allowed with the 2.5%, the new growth, and the excluded debt. But to get the calculation to work out for each individual property, you're never going to hit that value exactly. So it's a little below that, what we actually sent bills out for. Does that make sense? So you have excess capacity of $3,325. So that's the difference between those two numbers.
So I agree that the decrease from 50% to 40% of levy ceiling is worrisome, but I also agree that the fact that it's been steady for the past 5 years is a little bit reassuring. I picked marginal.
So the question is that I've always had, if we are restricted to a 2.5% rise in our levy that we can mm-hmm. tax, how do we manage to go from 52% down to 39%?
New growth and excluded debt.
We're spending more money than that 2.5%.
Yeah, new growth. Oh, but new growth should increase our.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, you're right.
It should. Yeah.
And if you go back to the assessed levy value,
you probably will see some of it there. This percentage is the percentage is increasing by 2.5%, not.
All right.
if we were doing that, then 10 years from now, we'll be out of zero.
What saves you is that your the value of your property increases over time, too. So the hope would be that the value of the property increases as much as your 2.5%, and so that your...
And it's not. Our total tax levy is increasing faster than our total assessed value.
It is.
That's...
And if we look at the tax bill page...
There's something,
debt override.
There's also something wrong with this excess as a percentage of maximum levy. If you take excess levy capacity, I assume that's the number they're talking about, and compare that with the maximum levy limit, 3% of $8 million is not $2,881.
Oh, yeah, good point.
Well, the one that kills you is down here where it's just 67%.
Right. I wonder if the zeros are in the wrong, that it should be 0.003.
Yeah, it's 0.03%.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
But that's okay. We'll blame it on the state.
No, I know so. But I can fix it. Anybody else have anything else to say about this?
No. So, what I was wondering is, how long is it going to take us where the override capacity, or whatever it is, that 52% down to 39%, mm-hmm. How many years before we hit zero if we go at this rate?
Well, if you look at
the last 4 or 5 years.
If you look 2018 to 2021, we're in pretty good shape. We went up 38 to 39.
It's been pretty steady.
We've had really good new growth over the past few years. And
wow, especially this year.
Inflation.
The highest ever.
We're going to get the condominiums. Huh? Condominiums are going to give it some.
Oh, right.
But they're not.
That wasn't all of it, though. It's something else.
No, it's not. Because what do you got? You got 70 condominiums that say $250,000 a piece. That's $20 million. That's not a ton of money.
What did you call it by number? No, but you got stuff.
What's
in,
that?
Deerfield Academy.
Mm-hmm.
And they put up a new sports building a couple of years ago. Then they put up a new medical building.
Is that an assessed value, though?
I think it's assessed, but I think it's also exempt.
Right.
And it shouldn't be one. We should.
No, it's still part of the assessed value, though.
We should exclude it from the calculations then.
You asked Karen that question.
I asked Karen, and she said that excluded is not in here. So, like,
right.
Deerfield Academy and
which
the,
it should be to get apples and apples.
Mm-hmm. We're trying to figure out how much we can.
I think if you take a look at our total assessed value for the town and figure out what's excluded, we get 20 to 30% of our total values excluded,
mm-hmm.
because of tax exempts.
Right. I'd say 30.
And we're one of the highest
plus
in the state.
Maybe as much as
than Boston.
Could be, yeah.
And large cities, where they have colleges in them.
Of course, in the case of colleges like the University of Massachusetts, the state contributes to Amherst.
Well, they have an agreement with Amherst that they will contribute a certain amount of money, and they do, because they have an agreement in hand. But we've never been able to do that here. Payment in lieu of taxes, pilot program.
Those nasty ones.
Because every time you try and talk to them, they just don't even want to talk to you. That's why they're willing to help us out with projects like, we'll throw you up a nice building there for the EMS for $500,000. That was totally tax-free, it's us. We just had to transfer the town over, the property over to them so they could build a building. They build a building and they donate it back to the town. Otherwise, they'd have to pay prevailing wage rate instead of a half million, would have cost them $1.5 million.
Unfortunately, this year, they've been asked to help with the congregational church.
Yes, they have.
In lieu of paying anything to the town for their donation.
I thought it was a certain amount of credit for it, but I didn't.
I was told in lieu of, and so if we don't get that money this year, then I can't budget in 2023 for anything from them for that. So that's gonna hit us, it's gonna hit us.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay.
You tell them I'm not too happy about that.
Might they just donate it anyway?
I would hope they would, but I don't know.
All right, so.
Just one last thing, let me throw in.
Yes.
I don't know how much, because we never really look at it. But anytime a nonprofit purchases a piece of property that's being taxed, comes off the tax bill, and it does nothing to lower taxes. We don't, or adjust them. So it's just
right.
Money that's gone.
Yep.
It's a tax assessment that's gone. Mm-hmm.
Which causes all of our tax bills to go up.
Yep.
Right.
Not by much, but you do
which
it
is
often.
Actually, let's hope the segue into indicator 4B.
How's that? Hopefully tree house will bring that.
Yeah, maybe that'll help.
Level that
out. Okay, that does bring up a question, though. One of the other things that take property off the tax rolls is town ownership. Mm-hmm. And I know that the town has been scrambling for ways to pay for things that the town owns. Is there any consideration to be given to deacquisitioning some of the town properties?
To getting rid of some of them?
Yeah, putting them back into the
I don't know. I don't know that the answer to that question.
We did.
But, one of them is the Oxford property.
Yeah.
Hopefully we'll be selling that soon.
We've been having that.
I think most of the rest of what we have are really small little pieces, and sometimes things that have no value to them unless they have town buildings.
Or it's property that we want to maintain. Whether it's the town common,
yeah.
Oh,
itself.
Right. Right.
But I've been wondering, for example, does that whole track off with Grayburn, which we have so much bother about, you know, just finding ways to have access to it to be able to use it for anything. Mm-hmm.
So one of the things that I always liked, and I thought was sort of interesting, I'm being facetious, is the Oxford property. We bought that. And we paid, I believe, $1.3 or $1.4 million.
$1.5 million, basically, yes.
And then the money that we borrowed, the interest that we paid on was another $200,000 or $300,000. So the gross amount was $1.8 million, thereabouts.
That was $1.8 to start.
Okay.
Go whatever the number was. Call it $2 million, would you?
$2
million. So what did we sell the property for?
$100,000.
Well, okay. But we carved out, what was it, 4.3 acres for the highway garage. So we gained something there.
It's true. It was 17 acres and roughly $100,000 an acre is what
right.
We paid for.
Yeah.
And what we sold it for is about $35,000 or $40,000 an acre.
Right, but we got some of that back.
We borrowed it back and paid for it.
Yeah, I was gonna say, we bought it back for the same thing, same amount we sold it for, but.
And now we'll sell it again for $50,000, so we're getting an extra.
We're aiming on it though.
The selectman come in and said, look, we bought it back for $39,000 and we sold it for $50,000. That means we made $10,000 a day.
We haven't made anything. But I understand that the reason we purchased that in the first place was not because we thought we could get value selling it. It was because we wanted to control who we sold to, right?
Yes.
Isn't that?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I mean, they could have put 70 units of condos in there.
Senior housing?
And sold them for $28 million that goes on the tax roll, but no.
All right, so indicator 4B is the tax bill. So this is driving at the fact that the tax rate does not tell the full story. So what this gives us is total single, if we go across, starting at the first column there, that's the total value of single-family properties. The number of single-family parcels, so we have an average value of a single-family parcel in town. Then we have a single-family tax bill, which is our tax rate times that average single value. So that's an average single-family tax bill. Then, I don't have any idea where this comes from, but there is a DOR income per capita for our town, and I don't know where they get that number. That's just available in that DLS gateway.
Is that the same number that's on here?
It's the DOR thing.
I think they get that from the taxes that are collected from each zip code. And the problem is that the zip codes are not consistent because we've got two zip codes in the town of Deerfield.
And some of those are people that actually live in Waitman.
And, yeah, yeah.
It's fairly close to income per capita that's on this.
Okay, it should be the same, it should be the same data source, so.
What are those asterisks referring to on the single-family tax bill? Like, but right at the title, it has a little star, but there's nothing.
I don't remember.
Okay, that's fine. Seemed like it was like a note.
So I just copied it.
Oh, sure.
When you download it, I just copied it, so there's some note at the bottom of the thing that I didn't copy. So then you can take that average single-family tax bill and take it as a percent of the income per capita, and you can take it as a percent of the something rather, the value of the property. Tax rate. So the things that I found interesting from this, one is the percent increase of our tax bill. And this is including excluded debt. So if you look, we've had, you know, well, it varies quite a bit, but we had one year that was really whopping 9.1%.
2015 was the start of the garage. Yep.
Great. But then on top of that 9%, we've been many years, well, we've been above 2.5% pretty much every year since 2017 because of excluded debt. So.
You know what debt, I don't know, the average working person is going to get a cost of living increase of 2-3%. And we're going up more than that.
Yeah.
So eventually, people are not going to be able to pay their tax bills.
direction it's heading, which you can say.
Tax bill went down, the tax rate went down, but my tax bill went up $300.
Well, assessed values are way up.
My tax bill went up 15%.
I think the real driver is the tax value has increased.
But if you look at, assuming I can do math, the rows below where it says 2022, the increase from 2011 to 2021 in single family values is 14%. The increase in income from 2011 to 2021 is 13%, so about the same. And the increase in the tax bill is 46%.
Where are you looking? I'm lost.
Way down at the tiny number.
We're down there.
Yeah, they're very small.
They are very small, sorry.
No, that's okay.
So I find that kind of alarming, frankly.
I think you're alone.
Not good.
So when you say single family values, that would be the total of all of the single family properties, is that what we're?
Yep.
As opposed to commercial and industrial.
So it's no commercial, no industrial, no multifamily, right? There's a few multifamily buildings in town.
I don't think there are many, but.
I don't think there's many.
Yeah, condos would probably go showing in here, single family.
Probably.
But.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know.
And then the DUR income per capita. So that's over the, whatever it is, 10 years.
So we send out a letter to the department heads saying, keep the service limit the same, right?
Level service.
Level services. And that's supposed to, I can see them increasing it by cost of living, inflation. But it looks like overall, we take the total appropriations, we're going way more than inflation. It's probably because of capital items.
But it's like. It's capital.
The tax bill increase of 4.1% is more than level services.
You have the schools in there too.
Yeah, it's true, right?
You'd have to compare what it cost us, what the increase in the schools.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see what it is without the school, or with the school by itself.
But I mean, as a tax bill, as a percentage of per capita income, is relatively flat. So where is the increase coming
from? Where's the increase? Yeah. Well, it went from 8% to 11%, 9% to 11%. I kind of feel like I need to check my math.
On what?
But again, I think that's a percentage of a percentage. 26% of 8.8%.
Yeah.
What'd you say again, Jim?
So, the average tax bill as a percentage of per capita income has gone from 8.8% to 11.3%, call it 12%. And so that is a 46% increase. But as a percentage of income, it has increased by only about 3%. Is it?
Yeah. Actually, that looks, the DOR income per capita, that looks a little strange, doesn't it? From 39,000 to 44,000 over 10 years.
What's weird is 2012 was 48,000.
Oh.
And then went down to 33,000 in 2015.
What did we say the DOR stuff?
Department of Revenue.
A 13% increase over 10 years, give or take. We're talking about an average increase of about 1%. So we're saying that the income per capita in the town of Deerfield has been increasing at roughly 1% a year?
Yeah.
while the rest of the world has been going up by 2.5-3%.
Is this perhaps inflation adjusted?
I don't think so. I don't think this is.
It's based on what people make.
I know, and so.
Relevance to a tax bill, other than you have to pay a tax bill.
Yeah.
Well, it doesn't. You would think that.
Where would this data come from? I mean, the department revenue.
From the tax.
Let's do our tax bills.
When you do your income tax.
Okay, it's all put into here.
So you get a whole lot of people cheating on their income tax.
Mm-hmm, that's it.
A lot of the town are retiring, so their income's going down. Some are still going up, some are going down.
Or some are staying steady, but that would, when everything else is going up, that's really what's going down.
Didn't we see, wasn't there indicated about ages?
There is at the end.
And what did that?
I don't know that I believe it. It says that our ages, our average age is increasing.
Shows that our average age what?
Is increasing.
Oh, it is.
Right.
Well, that would make sense, because if people retire, then their per capita income goes down.
Yep.
Shouldn't that also mean then that there's.
You get your big pay raise when you retire.
I know.
It said our average age is where?
So the, what it says is that the percentage of people in the 55 plus age group is going up, and the percentage of people in the 20 to 54 age group is going down. But that the weird thing is that the percentage under 20 is kind of staying the same. So people with kids are moving into town, I guess. But I also, these are estimates. It's U.S. Census data, and these are estimates. So it's not backed up by an actual count of people. So we need the 2020 numbers in order to see if this actually happened.
I feel like this is.
They're actually supposed to come out November 30th. I need to look. This is what?
I feel like this seems accurate to what we see.
And when we built 72 units, you have to be over 55.
And it's expensive to move here. It's real hard to move here if you're. It'd be hard to move here, you know, it's expensive.
Yeah.
So if you're like 20, it'd be hard to start off here.
So are we supposed to rate these?
On 4B.
On 4B?
Yes.
We didn't cover the other ratings.
No, we didn't. Let's look at 4B and then we'll look at the previous ones and see.
So this is our tax bills that we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Unfavorable.
I agree. Third.
We have three unfavorables.
John's tax bills go up 15%.
How much yours go up?
What happens when you rate these?
So I think what my plan is to go through all of this and for the finance committee to come to a consensus on this and then write me a much shorter summary that we need to advertise to the town.
That's your assessment.
My tax bill went up $300, $2,700 for 6 months, $27-something,
yeah.
To $3,000-something for 6 months.
Did you look at the assessment, John?
No, for last year, jacked up and it would go down.
Did you look at your assessed value?
Yes.
Yeah, that's
what
it is.
$46,000, yeah, nicely.
What?
In 1 year, it went up that much, come on.
But
I'm talking about my work last year, this year. Yeah, this year. Yeah, no, that's what I'm saying.
Increasing all those materials.
And then the tax rate went down 14%.
The tax rate went down, but my tax bill went up $300 cash.
That's because you have 5,000.
Because your house is always so much.
6,000.
Yeah, exactly.
So let's see. 1% of 6,000 would be 6 flat. So $300 would be roughly 5%.
Why are the property values increasing? Because nobody wants to move.
The value is increasing.
$100. Who reassess, like, $46,000 to make our property value?
My tax bill.
How much is your tax?
My tax going up $2,700 and something for 6 months, over 3,000.
I doubt it. So that's $300.
Warehouses.
I'm 27.
All right, we're kind of devolved into a bunch of conversations, so we're degrading. Okay, so indicator 4B tax bill, I feel like there's a consensus that it should say unfavorable due to the trend.
What's the vote? Everybody agrees, unanimous? I'm just curious.
I think so. I think everybody.
Nobody has said there are.
600.
So indicator 4A, do we want to come up with an assessment of that one? So this is our levy limit analysis. It's looking at our levy versus the levy ceiling.
So this is override. I think it's a good override capacity percentage of the levy ceiling. And I don't know whether we'll get there, but if you look at all the things that people would like to do in town.
And the newspaper today says that we're looking at $40 million of extra funding.
I read that too.
$40 million.
I haven't read today's paper
you
yet.
You should read it.
I read it in the
and emails. I think that exceeds our levy capacity.
Yeah, it does. All right, so
I think this is marginal because we're staying nice and steady on that, even though maybe it's not a good place to be steady.
I don't feel like we're in any danger right now, but if we go crazy spending stuff, then we're
well, $30 million on a wastewater treatment plant.
Yeah.
And I realize that the town is only going to pay that so-called 25%. But the people
but
in the
all
town
these people live in
are going to pay
too.
100%.
Yeah. And they're all taxpayers. So. Mm-hmm.
With the exception of the
with
DA
and whatever that
yeah,
pays.
Nonprofits.
Absolutely.
Do we pay for this motion to vote?
So we haven't really been voting on these, but we have a motion for marginal on the levy.
On 4A?
Analysis on 4A.
We have a motion for marginal, I'll second it.
You would call the, we're talking about which one here, this is the
4A.
4A, you would call that unfavorable, dropping from 52% down to 40%?
I would, because it's been steady for the past 4 years,
okay.
And we still have plenty of room left, but I wouldn't call it favorable. I would call
it
marginal, and we need to watch it.
Marginal.
Well, that's the only thing left if you go between favorable and unfavorable.
There you go.
Can we make formulation? Can we make it marginal unfavorable?
Marginal minus. B minus on that one.
Yeah, we've only been here an hour and 40 minutes.
Well, my alarm's going off at 7:30 and I'm going to go pick my kid up, so you all can keep talking after that.
So we have a vote?
All right.
Do
any
we need
further
to
discussion?
Okay.
Marginal. Oh, good.
All right.
You said marginal, didn't
marginal.
600.
Okay. Consensus that it's marginal.
Consensus that it's marginal.
We're not doing these as formal votes.
We're not doing formal
okay.
votes on these.
Consensus.
Consensus. So we're going backwards, are we?
We're working backwards, so.
For property tax revenue.
That one was too. All right. Property tax revenues. Anybody have a suggestion for an assessment? I said favorable because it's we're getting the tax. The I guess the idea behind this one is we're getting the money in, so it's working. The next two are like, yeah, but it's too much money, and so that's why it's marginal and favorable. But this, I mean, as far as have we been able to raise the money we need to pay for the stuff that we're spending? The money's coming in, so.
So we're raising what we need.
Yeah. Anybody disagree?
guess that's a consensus thing, huh?
All right, no argument against favorable, we're doing favorable on it. Okay, indicator three, state aid, we said marginal because it's dropping.
I would say it's unfavorable.
I go unfavorable too.
We're not getting the kinds of, one of the things that we don't see here is chapter 78. I don't know what's happened with chapter 78, not chapter 90, excuse me.
Chapter 90?
It's chapter 90.
That's been pretty, I think, pretty consistent from my recollection.
Chapter 90 for roads?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's around $300,000 per year.
Yeah, $350,000 or more a year.
Has it been going up?
The 3 or 4% that.
Probably not.
It's not going to go up until we take over Sugarloaf Street.
Yeah, that won't cover it.
I want to make that four-lane highway again.
And then put the cops out there to write tickets.
There you go. Increase our revenues. All right, so we have a motion, I guess, for state aid as unfavorable or recommendation.
That would be my two cents.
I agree with favorable.
Okay, everybody thinks that's unfavorable, so we will shift that. Indicator two.
You didn't even give us something to work with.
No.
Maybe change the name of that, that.
Oh, yeah.
Indicator.
Change it to what?
Free cash use for operating.
That was confusing.
I'm sorry about that. They changed the tab at the bottom to something else, but.
So we can take
free cash use. Yeah.
What are we saying?
They're changing the name of the number two to free cash use.
Does anybody have a?
I have been disturbed by it. I think we're using free cash to pay for something that should be, for stuff that should be operating.
So you want to call it what?
I consider it unfair, because basically it's like we're just. Either it is accounting ledger domain or it is trusting to luck every year. I'm not sure which is worse.
What are your thoughts?
I think it's marginal myself. Because we have been decreasing, and obviously it's on our radar to decrease it more. You're not going to change everything overnight. You're going to be working on it slowly.
And I think that's what we want to do. We don't want to radically change what we've been doing.
I agree with that. The EMS thing seems
I can go with that. But a lot of the free cash is coming from local windfall and local receipts, right?
Some of it.
A lot.
Not that much in the last couple of years.
But we were, so when, because we said earlier the local receipts is going up, it's kind of covering the downfall in state aid.
Well, it's.
So when you did the budget, you were bumping up local receipts also?
To what I can.
Okay.
You know, there were some estimates for fiscal year 22 that I had to adjust downward because we didn't collect the money that we would have liked to have collected last year.
Mm-hmm.
Particularly meals and rooms tax.
Right.
But there was one other category that I had to reduce down because I couldn't justify having an estimate of income more than what we had collected last year. So.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a couple of years before we get something that looks.
Right.
How come there's no industrial values for 20 and 21?
Because there weren't any on the DOR, that came off of the recap, and I did check those numbers. I don't know.
Industrial values?
Four D?
Yeah, where was that at?
Four D.
It was four D, okay. You've gone beyond this.
Wait, what are we doing for two?
Yeah, so we're looking at, let's finish indicator two before we look at that. So free cash use indicator two, we have a couple votes for marginal and at least one unfavorable.
I'll compromise at marginal.
I'll compromise. We'll stay with marginal.
Are we happy with marginal? All right. Indicator one, do we have? I recommended favorable kind of for the same reason that I did for indicator whatever it was. For property tax revenue, just from the rationale that we have enough money to cover what we're spending, so.
And there aren't any huge jumps in anything here, you know, which is, I think, a good thing.
Oh, so while we're talking about this, I do have a question. Local receipts, that's essentially sales tax and things like vacation tax.
Well, it's a long list. Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I was wondering, how much of those do we have control over? Like, we can't really change the motor vehicle excise.
No, pretty much zero.
Paying in lieu of taxes is a lot of.
Right. Inspection fees, you know, I think they collect enough in inspections. I don't think they're going to do anything with those fees. But I do know that our new Board of Health agent is working on raising some of the rates for the things that he charges for. Something that's long overdue, really.
But these, at best, should be sort of net zero type revenues, where they pay for the service that it's provided. It's not like they should be considered.
Some people say that.
That's where they should not be considered a revenue source, really.
I don't think that total receipts, I think by itself, is meaningless.
What's that?
I think total receipts by itself is meaningless. You have to compare it to what we're spending, or how it's the allocation of where it's coming from. And I have to say, state aid, we have a favorable. I don't think it means anything myself. As a standalone number.
I think if you were to start collecting marijuana revenues or more meals taxes because of treehouse, you know, something like that, I think that would be interesting. But you're right. I think when it's just a number by itself, it probably isn't as meaningful as something else. But this is, I think, still interesting to see, and it kind of shows you where you're at and that you could look back at it and say, well, here's where we had this jump because of this or this, you know, right now you don't see much, but.
At least it's not going down.
Right.
That would not be good.
None of them, yeah.
But so the fact that it's dull is okay. Is that what you're saying? The fact that it's dull is okay.
Yeah.
But basically they can't for that. Even you know, property tax, those are gonna go up. Because they, so what do we budget?
In theory, you could have a bunch of people default and not be able to sell property in town and not collect the property taxes.
In that case, we take the property.
And you don't get any tax from it.
Well, we take the property, we sell the property.
Right.
I mean, it's not that it happens very often, but.
It does.
I know at least one case, and that's the only one that I really know of.
Yeah, we have a few land and low values that need to be sold, but they're minimal.
But we also, 5 or 6 years ago, we decided to sell several pieces of property, and please correct me if I'm wrong, because it may very well be. In order to sell a piece of property, we have to put it off a bid, correct? So, when he comes in, you take a $100,000 piece of property, put it off a bid, you get two bids, one for $25,000 and one for $30,000, what do you do?
Charge him a lot in tax, considering.
We don't sell it. Or, we did sell it, and we got 25% or 30% of what it was.
All right, anybody argue with favorable for total receipts?
Meaningless.
Meaningless.
Which I can't argue with entirely, because it's basically we're collecting taxes, that's what it's.
Yeah, that's basically what it says. Okay, 4C, assessed value.
So what do we conclude on tomorrow?
I put favorable down just because it doesn't really mean anything.
Okay.
It's not that important. Okay. So we have like 5 minutes last week, probably, it would be nice to get through 4. 4C, assessed values. You know what, we don't have time to debate this. This is taking way longer than I hoped it would.
I think your assessed values are favorable. They're going up, generally.
But isn't that tied into the whole tax? We're just commenting on.
Yes, I guess the question is, how much does assessed value reflect actual value?
Well, ask the assessors. That's something I know nothing about, but yeah. Isn't it supposed to be like a percentage, like a 80% of what they consider the real value of the property, or isn't it a percentage of?
What's that?
Your assessed value on.
100%.
It is 100%.
It should be 100%.
Okay. But you know, there's the whole thing, you know, how much of this is driven by.
By,
you know, real estate speculation or whatever.
I think the more interesting thing is the new growth, which is 4D. Which has been kind of banging.
All over the place.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Which one you want?
4D, new growth.
What does that tell you? So in the column with residential for 2021,
those are all those condos.
Oh, okay. Because I was wondering, like, what kind of growth would give you this residentially?
That explains the zigzagginess, of course, because you know these projects take time to develop.
Right.
Well, so we've had. Go ahead.
This is new growth by class, mm-hmm. and I don't think it has a great meaning, honestly.
What's a commercial and industrial that's so huge in 2019?
Could it be the DuPont in 2019? When did they?
Who?
Is it DuPont? DuMont? What do they call it?
The one next to the highway garage?
Yeah. Who is that?
Yeah.
That's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking if that was the.
Yeah.
$10 million?
Well, there's that, and there was the little storage thingies, the storage units. That was about the same time, right? So I can't really
say. Thank
you. I guess it doesn't matter. It is what it is.
Yeah.
Although commercial went down.
Well, we had a couple big projects, and then we didn't last year. So
this is entirely new stuff. This is
yep.
Are we looking at the assessed, we're not looking at assessed values, right?
Well, the new growth.
Is that the increase from 1 year to the next 1 year?
No, it's new, it's not somebody, if you have a piece of property and it increases in value, that's not this. This is new stuff.
New pieces
condo,
of property.
New
something coming out of the tax
rules.
Right.
So I don't know whether, like a treehouse. No, because Channing Lee was still paying their taxes, right?
So that's why it's not on here.
They were paying $110,000 a year, if I remember correctly. So I mean, you compare what we're collecting.
Would they be commercial or industrial?
I don't know.
What else happened?
But it is treehouse commercial.
Oh, like if it's reclassified.
Could that just be something you need to call one category?
I don't think so.
I think this indicates new growth only over the old growth. Like, for example, when I turn around, so the Elm Street property that I have, which is residential, they put Cumberland Farms on there. They bought the thing, developed it, and then sold it to Cumberland. So I think that's part of the 2019 increase.
So that would be.
That was an increase because of the big increase.
Oh.
So the difference is when you go up from paying $4,000 or $5,000 a year to $25,000 a year makes a big difference.
You know that form, has everybody seen that form where it says, here's how many dollars you projected or whatever, what's your tax rate, taxes, add 2.5% for next year. The next number underneath that is something called new growth. That's what this is.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that one is the one that's going to fluctuate.
Mm-hmm.
An example would be over a year or two, or any other piece of property, the condos show up as new growth someplace in there.
Yep.
So part of this new growth analysis on 2021, part of that is for the new condos going in down on Sugar Loaf Street.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yep. You know, you take minimum $300,000 per condo, two per building, that's $600,000 times 35 buildings.
Yep.
That's part of it.
By how many years, whatever, 3 or 4 years that they, so, each year.
Personal property.
Yeah, I don't get that.
That doesn't make sense, that's.
That doesn't make sense.
Do you get a little loop on that one? That's the one that the state builds that, right?
Personal property?
That's the excise tax on property.
No, we build that.
That's the one companies fill out themselves and send in and say, here's our value.
Well, it's right, basically, the desks and bookcases and.
Yes.
All that sort of stuff. Yes.
Metal stamping machines.
Mm-hmm.
To go up $2.5 million and $2.3 million.
Lots of bonus.
I don't know, that's kind of hard to believe.
Hard to believe that amount of money, yeah.
Right.
We used to send Bruce out every year to see if he.
Well, Bruce was back here when you got the $7 million.
That's right.
All right, so it's 7:30, so we need to wrap up. Or at least I'm leaving. Y'all can keep talking if you want to. But do we want to meet again about all of this?
If you're going to.
Well, you still got three items to go, 6, 7, and 8.
If you're going to publish it, yes.
Yeah, so. Do you want to meet again next week, or do you want to just wait till after New Year's?
There's the training next week.
Oh, the training's next week, yeah. Let's meet in January. Finish it off in January.
You don't want to meet between Christmas and New Year's?
Oh, not. I'm not working a minute during that time period.
Don't put that on my
mind. Yeah, don't put that on that. I'm always checking my email. It's a disease.
And there'll be some residue. The subject.
The
11th. And payroll checks go there.
So,
no, it happens.
I would actually prefer Thursday.
Okay.
Do you think we can move to Wednesdays?
Okay.
Wednesdays are the
somebody
library
could do
board
Wednesdays.
Meets on Wednesdays.
But problem with Wednesdays is you're competing with the
select board. Yeah, so if we want this room.
Right. Yeah, right.
But in mind.
Do Thursdays work for people?
What's that?
Thursdays, not the second Thursday of the month, but otherwise generally.
Let's keep it the same. Never mind.
Okay.
On the other hand, which is more important, the work that we're doing or the work that the selectmen are doing?
We do.
So we are looking at January.
We didn't get a date.
Stop.
11th?
11th is not good. Neither Jim nor Ally can make the 11th.
Do we need a majority? I mean, I hate to exclude them, but.
No, that's true. You have a quorum.
I have the four.
So.
That sounds terrible.
Are you the 11th of January is what you're talking about?
Fourth. January 4th.
Fourth of January. Good.
4th January.
What date is that? That's a Tuesday?
That's a Tuesday.
Okay. I left my phone somewhere.
Is that at 5:30 again?
What time are we supposed to be? 5:30?
5:30 is good, yeah.
17:31 or 22, yikes.
What's that?
All right.
January 4th, 5:30, we're just going to continue the same agenda, right?
We still have that class next Monday night.
We do have class next week.
And then January 4th is the next finance meeting.
Is there a place to recycle the old one if I don't, the one that's not the right copy?
There's a, there should be a blue bucket in that copy room. If not, I'll take it and I'll put it in my blue bucket. Yeah.
Okay, oh, we need to adjourn.
I'll confuse myself.
Would anybody like to move to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn. Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unanimous.
Do we have to do a roll call?